in this part of chapter 8, we are actually starting to prepare for chapter 9. So today our topic is indeterminate forms and L'Hôpital rule. A couple of historical details about L'Hôpital rule, which is very popular among students, because you will see why it really helps us to calculate some unpleasant limits. Just a little detail about the spelling of his name. It's interesting, in some books it is spelled as L'Hôpital like this. And in some books the way we spell it. And then I remember seeing at the conference actually first page of his paper. I think that's 16th century. 7th. Yeah. And 7th century. And it was spelled this way. So for a while I was spelling it the way he was spelling his name. But then later on I found out that basically what happened in the meanwhile, there was a change in the French grammar and phonetics, and then actually the new French to spell his name is this one, so that's probably the proper way to do it. Anyway, enough of history. Let's see what is the whole this thing about. Let's consider the following limit. For example, limit when x goes to 2, 3x minus 7 over x plus 4. So what is this? We are asked here to calculate this limit. And let me review that from calculus 1. A limit is something that might be often close to the value of the function, but it's not the same thing, otherwise we wouldn't get the same name. So value of the function is, one can say pre-calculus, limit of the function is calculus. They very often coincide, but they are not the same thing. Why? Because when we talk about limit of f of x, when x approaches a, some number L, and I'm not going to go to formal definition, meaning of this is, not going to be definition, if x is close to A, that will imply that f of x is close to L, whatever that means. So you see, we are not plugging in the value A, but we are considering all the values that are very close to A, and then if there is a trend, then we say that's a limit. And then what? If function f, if f is continuous, at x equals A, then limit f of x when x approaches A is exactly f of A. And then, and that very often happens, and that's why very often we just get limits plugging in the value that will happen here. This function is continuous at x equals 2. How do I know? Because these are two polynomials. Quotient of two polynomials is always continuous, except when at that point the denominator has value 0, which is not the case. So I just plug it in, 3 times 2 minus 7, over 2 plus 4, which is negative 1 over 6. Done. It was very, very easy. But let me consider now the following case. Example, limit when x goes to 2, sine of 2x minus 4 over x minus 2. No, over, sorry, copy. We can do this one just to avoid discrepancy. Minus 2, this is 2x minus 4. Now we want this limit. That first, I call it very often optimistic strategy, will not work because when we plug in x equals 2 in the denominator, denominator is equal to 0. Basically, what we are getting here, we are getting the form, we wouldn't be stuck if the top number would not give us, if top gave us 7, then we would get something like 7 over 0, and then 7 over a very small number, more more precisely, and that could be just determined by a common sense, we would say that limit is plus or minus infinity. But here we have one of those indeterminate forms, 0 over 0. That's called indeterminate form. Form y, because you cannot just looking at it decide if the limit exists, and if it does, how much is it? You have to analyze much closer. Generally, it's just two small things are there, so you really need to put it under the microscope and zoom in to see really how they relate. And this is not the only indeterminate form. There are the other indeterminate forms that I better write in here so that we know we'll face them here. It is also infinity over infinity, so indeterminate forms, though that really need special treatment. Infinity over infinity, 0 times infinity. What else? 1 to infinity, actually, is one of the indeterminate forms. And we might add, and if a of all, of course, the big one is infinity minus infinity. So these forms just cannot be decided. Just looking at them, we need a more precise analysis. So what are we going to do here? Generally, we will describe, we will explain what is really happening with the L'Hopital rule. So we'll kind of announce the rule. So what's happening is the following. So let me draw the pictures here. So 2x minus, so everything is happening around x equals 2. So here is that point, x equals 2. So on the denominator, we have line 2x minus 4. So line 2, I'll draw it a little bit less steep than it really is. It doesn't matter. Let's say we only need the rescale. We'll just think a little better. So here is y equals 2x minus 4. And then sine of x minus 2, sine of x minus 2 looks, yes, that's good. Here both functions have the value 0, and then what I don't know is how steep. I know how steep is the line, but I'm not sure how steep is my sine function, so it might be that my drawing is not accurate. But generally what would help is if I approximate this function, approximate by the tangent. We should be able to know how to do it because that's one of the main lines of calculus 1. So what do we do here? So we are considering function g of x equals sine of x minus 2. So we want the slope of that line. I don't know, as I said, what that is. I better not draw it before I calculate it. So g prime of x is cosine of x minus 2. Then I'm going to make it equal, I plug in x equals 2, so I get that g prime of 2 is cosine of 0, which is 1. So that tells me that that slope of my red function is 1, and this one is 2, so probably I drew it too steep. So let me draw that. Flatter. So here is that sine function, and it will go basically that red graph. Which is better if it goes like this. So what do we do then? We can now make the equation of the blue line, and we can say the following. The blue line has the slope. This is the slope, so tangent line. Point is So I go points lower 40, y minus y zero, y minus zero equals x minus 2, slope is 1, so the line y equals x minus 2. So this is the line y equals x minus 2. So what can I do here? I can now continue my limit. Let's say limit when x goes to 2, 2x minus 4, and here I will approximate that red function with the tangent line function x minus 2 plus something very small. I don't know how I wrote it in my notes, or I just approximate it plus something, I better say, very small, meaning even because x minus 2 is also small, this is smaller at the higher level. So what would that be? Now things are very easy. I have x minus 2. I will neglect that very small expression. X minus 2. We cancel x minus 2 and x minus 2. And we get the limit 1/2. So generally, when you zoom in, these tangent lines say, oh, green function is twice bigger than blue function. That little tiny extra, very small, is really irrelevant in that comparison because it's even smaller, and then the ratio is approximately 1/2. So this idea is actually formulated in our next theorem, and that's theorem of the day, and that's the Hopital rule. So I will just summarize. The theorems are important tools in mathematics. So you just summarize our methodology and clearly state with the picture to illustrate it. So clearly say what are the conditions to apply and what are your benefits of theorem. Says let f of x or let f and g be differentiable. On some interval a, b. So we needed the derivative to get a slope, so we need a differential containing point c. So here they are, one is f, one is g, here is the point c, here is the interval where you need your comfort zone. That's the only thing that A and B, A and B don't participate in calculation, they are just your comfort zone. C is where things happen. Differential containing point C except C itself. So that means where they might not be continuous. So everywhere in AB you want function to behave well, at C you allow them to be either not only non-differential, you allow even not to be continuous, not to have value, doesn't matter. And then what if, and this is crucial, limit f of x is 0 when x approaches C, limit the g of x when x goes to c is 0, then a limit of f of x and g of x when x approaches c equals limit of f prime of x, g prime of x when x approaches c. So what happened here? And that's exactly what we did here. Although that limit in the second stage were just the values, so it was very easy to calculate. What he tells you here is, if you have both these limits are zero at the point, so values are very close to zero, it might fail at the point itself, but around that value, around C, both functions are very close to zero. And then you can replace quotient of the function with quotient of the derivatives. Be careful, this is not like quotient rule or anything like that. It has nothing to do with that. You are not calling quotient rule, you are just replacing limit of the functions with the limit of the derivatives and of the limit of the quotient of derivatives. And as I said, the reason is, and the proof is, exactly because you are doing tangent line approximation. And then, so let me write the proof. So what are we doing? We are saying the following. I will just write the proof where let limit f prime to x when x goes to c. Just to make notation simpler, I will just assume that limit f prime of x when x goes to c is the same as f prime of c. As I said, if that's not the case, then we will just need a little more complicated notation, but idea is the same, and let's say that that will be k. And then that limit g prime of x when x approaches c equals g prime of c, and that is L. Then what? The same way as we did in our example. Limit. We just approximate each of them with a tangent line. F of x is actually what? F of c plus its derivative, which is k times x minus c, and here is g of c plus l times x minus c. And then we assume that f of c and g of c exist and they are equal to zero. So we get the limit when x goes to c, k times x minus c, l over x minus c. We cancel them out, they are not zero, they're just small numbers. And we get k over l, which is exactly quotient of two derivatives. As I said, this is a little less general proof. But if I were to do it at arbitrary point, then there will be more, just heavier notation of the same thing. All right, let's see how this theorem works and how it helps us to calculate some limits that would otherwise be much more complicated for calculation. So here it is, limit, for example. A limit when x goes to zero, famous limit that you remember from calculus one. But here we can just, if you have L'Hopital rule, we can derive it quite easily. Be careful, always when you want to use L'Hopital rules, check if those two limits or two values for continuous functions are really giving us the value of the limit zero. So sine zero equals to zero, which is limit, and then also on that denominator also gives us zero. So we have zero over zero. So it is okay to use L'Hopital rule. Be careful, if you don't provide zero over zero, not only that L'Hopital rule is not needed, it will just give you the wrong result. So it's crucial in that proof that both limits are zero or very often values based. X goes to zero, now we take derivative of sine x. Let me do a longer notation. Sine x over derivative of x, which would be a limit when x goes to zero, cosine x over 1. And now what? Now the theorem just says these two are limits are equal. Sometimes the second limit exists, sometimes it doesn't, but doesn't matter, that's the same answer as your question. This time, limit does exist because functions are continuous, we can use our original strategies, so it's cosine 0 over 1, the limit is 1. So that's the whole idea. And now we'll just keep doing similar problems. Limit equals to 0, 1 minus cosine x over x squared, which is, we call that colloquially 0 over 0. Of course, you cannot divide by 0, but that means when you plug in a value on top and on the bottom, both values are 0. Really, cosine 0 is 1, 1 minus 1 is 0 over 0. It's all good, so okay to okay. So what do we get here? Limit when x goes to 0. Derivative of x squared is just 2x. Derivative of 1 is 0. Derivative of negative cosine x is sine x. But what happens here, if you try to plug in like a minute ago, you get 0 over 0 again. But then what is that telling us? That we can use L'Hopital rule once again. And what would that give us? Cosine x here, derivative of 2x is 2. So see, if you get 0 over 0, you keep differentiating as long as you see the progress. Sometimes L'Hopital rule actually makes things more complicated than they were. But as long as things look better and better, keep doing it. When I plug it in, I get 1 half. And that's the limit. What we want to do now is just to see little different examples. What would that be here? We want the limit when x approaches 2 minus square root of 4 minus x squared over x minus 2. Why is this important? To approach 2, what is 2 minus? That means that we are approaching 2 from the left side, which is basically makes sense because this function is 4 minus x squared is defined between negative 2 and 2. So 2 you cannot approach from the right side, you can only approach 2 from the left side. So what do we do? If you plug it in, we'll get 0 over 0. So we have, again, L'Hopital's rule. And generally, we have an undetermined form. So we'll use L'Hopital's rule. One can object that actually we don't have the whole interval of differentiability. But that's the whole world, because your function doesn't lose the differentiability, it just doesn't exist there. So that's full interval of its existence. So it's okay to apply L'Hopital rule. So what do we get here? So we get derivative of x minus 2 is 1. Derivative of square root, square root of u prime is 1 over 2 root u times u prime. So it will be 1 over 2 square root. Squared, and then derivative of 4 minus x squared would be minus 2x. So what happens? So we get 2 here and 2 here, and then we get what? Limit when x goes to minus of negative x over square root of 4 minus x squared. And what happens here? I'm not too happy with what I got because it looks like maybe the same thing, it's just numerator and denominator replace the spots. But here's the story. If I try optimistic strategy to plug in, this is just a comment, what do we get? On top, we get negative 2. On the bottom, we get small number, something very close to 0, not really 0. So then, for this one, this is not in determinant form. This one I can decide using common sense. Why? Because when you divide negative 2 by a very small number, you will get actually a huge value, infinity. And then because of this minus, we get negative infinity. So that's our answer. So you remember from calc 1, we say what? That basically limit does not exist. So that's the final answer. If someone asks you in the multiple choice, does this limit exist or not? You would say no. But then what is that telling us? It's telling us actually the dysfunction has vertical asymptote at 2 minus. All right. Now we'll start exploring some other undetermined forms where we want to see how to apply L'Hopital rule. Be careful, L'Hopital rule could be applied only if you have a quotient. So generally, the whole strategy now is how do you build quotients? So here's an example. Limit when x goes to infinity, x tan 1 over x. If I just try plug-in strategy, 1 over infinity is 0, so this approach is 0, and this approach is infinity. Standard error that people often make here is anything times 0 is 0, and they just give us the answer 0. That's wrong. Why? Because this expression is not 0, this is just small. So if this expression is small, this one's big, so there's a fight. So it depends who pushes stronger. Does this one push more to make values bigger, or this one push strong to make values smaller? So you cannot see that. So you have to do a subtle analysis. So what are we gonna do here? I like to have a quotient, and here's how we build quotient. So here's again a bag of tricks. I think of this fraction as over 1. And then I will divide up and down by x. And what will happen? I get like this, x tan 1 over x over 1 over x, which is a limit when x goes to infinity. Basically, one can say that I just did magic, that x disappeared on top and appeared on the bottom as reciprocal, which is okay because dividing by 1 over x and multiplying by reciprocal. Why am I so much happier here? Because 1 over x is close to 0, tan of 0, so I get 0 over 0. I actually here also applied the extended version of L'Hopital rule because it was formulated when x approaches specific value. L'Hopital rule under the same assumption could be applied when x goes to infinity. So what do I do here? I can then apply L'Hopital rule. Happens. Derivative of tan will be secant square 1 over x times negative 1 over x squared. Derivative of tan u is secant square u, and then chain. Derivative of 1 over x is minus 1 over x squared. And then what happens? I cancel negative 1 x squared, negative 1 x squared, and now I plug in infinity. 1 over infinity is 0, small number. Secant of 0 is 1. It worked quite well. This was the good move. So this move was crucial. Everything else was straightforward. Let me show you one more thing that would make this a little nicer. If you like it, you can use it. If not, then just disregard my comment. The thing that you can do here is something that people change variables for limits. People rarely do it. People do it for intervals, but not for limits. But generally, if you do it, here's what you can do. Let's say that u equals 1 over x. Then what happens? Limit. If x goes to infinity, u goes to 0. You get tan u over u. Why do I like it more? It's still L'Hopital rule, but now I don't have a chain rule. So I get secant square u over 1. And then I get what? It's a little cleaner. Because x goes to infinity, since I have everything in terms of 1 over x, it might be easier in terms of u. Right. Here are a couple of other indeterminate forms. So anyways. So what would that be? Next example is the limit of 1 over x sine x minus 1 x squared when x goes to 0. And the worst thing here would be to split these two limits. Why? Because the rule for splitting says splitting is okay only if those individual limits exist, but they don't exist. So that would ruin the whole thing. So when they are together, then interaction might help us to achieve the limit. But if you split them, you ruin everything, and it's not legal. So what is the only, what is the thing here? When I go one over small number, this is infinity, minus infinity. So fight of two infinities, who wins, we don't know before we do the little analysis. So what's a common sense to do here, just to common denominator? So we want to write it as a single quotient. So it's x squared sine x. First expression is missing x, I multiply by x over x. Maybe more careful what you want. Here is x over x, here is sine x over sine x. So we get what? X minus sine x. So what's what we have now? We have 0 over 0. Absolutely good for L'Hopital rule. So that will give us limit. When x goes to 0, derivative x is 1 minus cosine x. What about denominator? I'll use the product rule. Official product rule, not L'Hopital's version. So product rule will go 2x sine x plus x squared cosine x. What happens here? If I plug it in, I would get again 0 over 0. So I don't know if we are doing better, hopefully. But then since it's 0 over 0, I can do L'Hopital again, although I'm a little worried. The things look worse and worse instead of nicer and nicer. But let me try it once again. The derivative of 1 minus cosine x is sine x. On the bottom, again, I have product rule, so it will be 2 sine x plus 2x cosine x plus 2x cosine x minus x squared sine x. Do not look good. So, things look more and more complicated, and I still keep getting 0 over 0. Obviously, these two together could be combined to give me 4x cosine x. So, I'll try once again. If although there was a trick to divide by x and then see the limit immediately using some limit that we know from before, but we just do the brute force. So the derivative of sine x is just cosine x. Good news, because this is not zero sum. It has to stop one way or the other. The derivative of 2 sine x is 2 cosine x plus, remember this is 4x cosine x. So product rule says 4 cosine x. 4x sine x. Whew. There's a minus here, so it will be 2x sine x plus x squared cosine x. And finally, we plug it in. When I plug in 0, I get cosine 0, which is 1. On the bottom, I get 6, and that's it. Why do I get 6? Because this is 6 cosine x. When I plug it in, cosine 0 is 1, so I get 6. This guy is 0 because it has x. This guy is 0 because it has x. This one has also x. So this limit is 1 over 6. So when it looked really disastrous, actually, we were able to improve it. So the limit is 1 over 6. All right. Here is another example. As I said, now we just go from example to example to see how different configurations use L'Hopital rule differently, or how do you prepare it actually for L'Hopital rule. Here's the problem labeled in my notes as number 15. It's a limit of to the x. When n is goes to 0 plus. By the way, well, it definitely helps a little trigonometry. Cosine of 90, this is complementary angle for x, so that's the same as sine. So what do we have here? If I plug it in, I'll get 0 to the 0. And I don't know what that might be. I'll add it here as another indeterminate form because I don't have intuition to tell you what that means. So it's like a small number, but really raised to the very small power. So it's like a small number taking a heavy root out of it. I have no idea what to do. But here is the general rule that says whenever you are dealing with complicated powers, the best strategy is just to label it and call it down. How do you call it down? You take a length. So I just take a name. So A is basically sine x dx. And then when I take ln A, that would be ln of sine x to the x, which would be x ln of sine x. All right, so now I'm proceeding really to calculate the limit of ln a, because then at the end I'll just reverse to a itself. What is this? Now I'm doing better. This is ln 0, which is infinity, negative. And this approaches 0, so I'm back to 0 times infinity, which I know how to handle much better. What do we do here? It's over 1. Remember the trick from a minute ago. If I divide by x, I can get ln sine x over 1 over x. It might be a good idea to call this b so that I can carry it around. So limit of this expression b when x goes to 0 plus, I get what? This is limit when x goes to 0 plus ln sine x 1 over x, which is what? We can call L'Hopital rule, and that will give us derivative of ln sine x is 1 over sine, 1 over u prime, which is cosine x. Derivative of 1 over x is negative 1 over x squared. I don't know if this looks any better, but first, whatever I want to do, it's much better to just simplify this fraction. So I'm dividing by 1 over x squared is multiplying by the reciprocal. So that would give us a limit when x goes to 0 plus cosine x over sine x times x squared over 1 minus 3. So dividing by 1 over x squared is the same amount. Now what? Now Billy Graham, quite tempted. All right, and let's finish this integral. If we test L'Hopital rule, we will get again 0 over 0. We can do some split up like I did in the note, but you can also do L'Hopital because it's 0 over 0. Derivative of sine x is cosine x. Derivative of x squared cosine x would be negative sine x times x squared plus cosine x times 2x. And now if we plug in x equals 0, the denominator we get 1, the numerator we get 0, so the whole limit is 0. But obviously that's not our answer because that's not the limit of b. But then what do we get? We get that b is close to 0. So from this connection that B equals ln A, I'm gonna write that first. So B equals ln A, we can resolve that A equals e to the B. So A approaches e to the 0, which is 1. So our answer here is this limit is 1. Right, a couple more problems with a similar flavor. Problem number 71. Limit f to the 1 over x when x goes to infinity. What is the form of this one? It is infinity to 0. So what do we do in order to compare them? We'll do the same thing. So we'll say a equals x to the 1 over x. Then we will take ln a, which is ln of x over 1 over x. Then 1 over x, we factor out. We get 1 over x ln x, or that's ln x over x. And now we take a limit. Same problem like a minute ago. X goes to infinity, ln x over x. If we plug it in, we get the form infinity over infinity, which is also one of the acceptable forms for the L'Hopital rule. So then what do we get? Derivative of ln x. Ln x prime. It's very short, so we can go in a little more details. The derivative of ln x is 1 over x. Derivative of x prime is 1. Calculated that 1 over infinity is 0 over 1, which is 0. But that's the same thing, so we can say what? Again, we have to call it B like a minute ago. So we can say that B is close to 0. And then if B equals ln A equals e to the B is close to e to the 0. So this limit equals to 1. Generally, when we apply this type of reasoning that we apply twice, in the last few minutes, we are really using the continuity of exponential function. And the exponential function is everywhere continuous. So generally, if b is close to 0, then e to the b is close e to the 0. So if inputs are close, outputs are also close. That's basically what existence of the limit means. And then exponential functions continue, so that's what we